like to read, I'm impressed. Some people don't like reading, and that's all right. But some people just love it. And I always carry a book with me. And then on it, I have attached my to-do list. I know, OCD. But I like to keep my list, and I like it when I finish it, and I can scratch it off. And then I have kind of a list over here of things that still are left to do. The book that I'm reading now and I'm studying is called Organizational Leadership and Foundational Practices for Christians. That's the book I'm reading right now. I need to finish this by tomorrow. I won't. That's why I'm really kind of overwhelmed at this point. I will get through this. Only 2 more years left of this program. That sounds like such a long time. But anyway, I've read somewhere some books are to be tasted, others to be swallowed, and some, a few, to be chewed and digested. I like that. I think that many books today, the authors are just trying to entertain people. And that things that aren't, they use things that aren't facts, kind of fantasy. Some of it's dirty, but it's just meant to entertain people. And it seems that books are less and less challenging spiritually. Where is the books that challenge us and make us grow? It seems the writers today are just want to impress our emotional pleasure. But then there are some books that do challenge us, and they truly are masterpieces to be chewed, digested, studied, discussed, pondered, memorized, reread, and applied to our everyday life, right? And for us, as believers, we have been blessed with the Holy Scriptures. These 66 books are amazing and God-inspired. Just think, 66 books, what a blessing to have the Bible. Some people don't like to read it, they like to see it on video tape. Well, praise the Lord for that. 66 books. When we read the Bible, when we read our scripture, it's been read for thousands of years. And if Jesus doesn't return soon, people will continue to read the scripture for thousands of more years. Just imagine that. Isn't that cool? It's not a fad that lasts a short while, like clothes do, and then the fad fades, or that new idea, and then it fades. The scriptures have been read and chewed and swallowed and digested and memorized and enjoyed and discussed, and people have grown for thousands and thousands of years, and it will continue. That is so cool. Very cool. Personally, I like to read true stories, such as bibliographies or autobiographies. Sometimes people will write books about themselves or about other people. And I really like to hear it straight from the person who experienced that situation. That's the kind of books that I like to read. Books that help me to imagine what it was like to be there, to go through that experience. And to be able to imagine how that back to your life. And then today's our text segment was written by Paul, and he has an enormous life-changing event in his life. And that makes his writing even more powerful, because it's about his experience and how it impacts him. If you're familiar with Paul, you know that before he was known as Saul. Saul was a very devout Jew. He was from the town of Tarsus, and he was also a Roman citizen. So he was a Jew, and he was also a Roman citizen. He grew up in what would be called a fundamentalist Jewish household, which was very strict household. And Saul left Tarsus. Got a visual here. There, and he traveled, there you go, and traveled to Jerusalem. And there he studied under the most famous rabbi in the Pharisee sect. The rabbi's name was Gamaliel. So Paul studied under him. He was Saul's instructor. He was a very famous rabbi and teacher. And at that time, it would have been like IED education. And people who studied under him were considered very powerful and influential. So Saul was very intelligent and very well-known and powerful Pharisee. He had the best education, very knowledgeable, and very famous. And Saul's intent for his life was to teach and promote the Jewish kingdom. Jewish laws, rules, the commandments. So he grew up and received this good education and wanted to pass that along. But God had a different plan for Saul. He studied under the famous rabbi. Time schedule, all this hard work. But his plan for the future was to promote the law with his intellect, and then God had a different plan. Just think, to be famous and have authority and people honor you. That was his plan. And you know, Saul did persecute. He wanted the Jewish kingdom to grow, and he would kill the people, the follower of the way, because they were interfering with his plan to grow the Jewish kingdom. So if they were interfering, he needed to get the Christians out. And he did so by killing them. Having them killed. But while he was traveling to Damascus, Jesus showed up and changed God's life, or changed Saul's life forever. Saul, on the way to Damascus, Saul died. And Jesus, God, raised him. Okay. Saul became Paul. Paul was his new name and is representing his new life. Instead of destroying the church and growing the Jewish kingdom with his intellect and his IED education, Saul died on that road. And God sent him on a different track. Instead of destroying the church, he became a part of building and growing the church. Come on! Praise the Lord! That is a big, impactful story. He studied under Gamaliel for many years. He invested his time, his money, everything to receive this IED education. And he would be famous and honored. And then God said, come on, Paul. Go build my church. And Paul, you know the story of Paul. Yes, he did become famous, and he was educated, but he suffered immensely for Jesus. And in our text this morning, Paul writes of God's sovereignty and his grace, and he does it with such passion that as the reader reads it, chews and swallows and digests everything that he's read, and as we discuss it, we read it and memorize it, true story. Paul went through what he's talking about here. It's not a fake story. It's not. So I'm going to reread verses 3 through 7. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. And in love he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. One thing very cool about the scripture is that Paul uses the Greek word eulogia, which means praise, a blessing. And you know, when we attend funerals, you'll often people will give a eulogy, talk about the person, give praise to the person who's passed, and talk about all the wonderful things about that. It's called a eulogy. And it comes from this word, eulogia. So Paul wrote and uses this word three times in this verse. Praise, thanksgiving, three times in one sentence he uses this word. Paul wrote almost like a liturgy, like we do sometimes for the reader, and then the congregation responds. And if you would go home and then you read further into this chapter, you'll see that Paul writes the doxology. You know, like praise the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. A doxology is a short hymn of praise that is sung during worship. And that practice comes from Judaism. They would take, there's many Christian practices that have been taken from Jewish practices. But they would, the doxology is a shorthand. It used to be that very traditional churches would use, do this practice, very traditional churches still use this practice of singing these short doxologies. So it's praise God for all his blessings. And I think you remember when we used to sing this when we're at fellowship at First Baptist Church? Praise God for all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Do you remember? Do you remember when we used to do that? It's beautiful and it's very meaningful. Because we often forget to praise God for all our blessings. This morning when I went in, came in here, all the names, too hot, it's too cold, and blah, these are things that I can't control. He's mad at me, Dad, he took my home, ew. I don't know, I'm just making things up. But when I came in, everything was so positive and it made me feel so inspired. You know, positivism will influence those around you. And it will build people up. Negativity tears us down. But Paul writes, he says, hey, remember, Paul is educated. He has 1,000 times more education than I have. He tells us, come on, praise God. Praise God. Every embryo, God already has a plan. Is that cool? That is cool. And that's love. And that's grace. Third, Paul says, praise God. God has adopted us. We have been adopted into God's family. We are heirs. We receive eternal life and fellowship with the Trinity and the promise of the resurrection. Our post-resurrection bodies are going to be so perfect. So perfect. And I'm looking forward to that. And fourth, Paul says, please, praise God because he has redeemed us. God has redeemed us through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We are redeemed by God's grace and through our faith. And fifth, praise God, he has forgiven us. We're saved. Our debt is paid in full. Maybe Christians don't realize that. People don't realize that we're sinners and that our debt is paid off when we accept Jesus as our Savior. When we first accept Him, maybe we're excited about it and everything, but then we forget. Life in Christ is beautiful and amazing. It's different. So, in this passage, Paul is writing it to Doxology, and he's saying, praise God for these reasons that we have listed up here. Praise God because he lists all the many blessings, these five blessings. And if you read the Bible regularly, you will notice that people make lists. You probably thought only your pastor is the one that does that. But the Bible is full of lists. Lists of thanksgiving. They list of blessings. The Bible is full of lists. Old Testament and New Testament. It's full of lists of why we should be happy. This, when we sing these praise songs, we should be like, praise God. What was the song? Oh, yeah. God saves. Our God saves. I have hope in His. No, that's not how we're supposed to sing. We're supposed to be excited. Our God saves. What if Jesus had not come?
How to grow spiritually. That's my job.
make a list of reasons that you individually should praise God. It may sound dumb, but lists are wonderful. Would you say? He said, I won't finish my list. Oh, it would be so long, I would not be able to finish my list. And God is pleased to hear and see that comment. So make a list. If you're too busy, make time. Because this is very important for you to train yourself to develop a habit. Just don't say, I'll just think about it. No, I want you to actually write it. Writing it makes a difference. Writing it and reading it. And rereading it and adding to it. It really makes a difference when you see it. You know, as people, we're visual people. But here's people that need to write it too. There is a huge sin in the world today. It's the sin of negativity. I call it a sin because it blocks your relationship with God. Our culture teaches us, as little people, to be negative and to complain. I don't like it. It's too cold. I don't like it. It's too hot. Oh, this smells awful. This is too small. Oh, that's too big. That's not fun. I'm bored. I need more tech. I need bigger tech. I need fancier this and fancier that. We learn that from as little children. To be negative. Am I right? Negativity steals your joy and it blocks your relationship. And it does it quickly. Most people tend to see the glass half empty. Remember I showed that visually? I see, I hear every day. And myself, I'm trying to stop myself in the middle of my mental thoughts, negative thoughts. And I'm getting pretty good at it. When I'm sleeping and having insomnia, and my mind's thinking of all these different things that might be negative, I try to stop myself. And it does take practice and discipline, but you can develop the practice of capturing your thoughts. People need to stop complaining and speaking negatively. When something comes up in our mind, we need to sometimes, instead of just immediately saying it or signing it, I often think, why did I say that? We're discussing something legitimate, but we're just things that come up and complaining. When you see the cup half empty instead, think of it as half full. That will refresh my soul. It's sad that we live in the world of the glass half empty. He wants his children to stop and recognize all the wonderful blessings that he has lavished on us. God wants that. He desires that. He wants his children to speak, sign to him, communicate with him. That's what he wants. It needs to come from your heart. It needs to come from your heart. You really have to be glad, happy to worship Him. Even if you have to worship Him, it's here. the fellowship hall to worship in today while that's being fixed. We didn't have to sit in the sanctuary with our gloves and hats and mittens on. We need to be positive and it needs to come from the heart. So now, after you make your list, I want you to reread it and kind of think about it, meditate on it. How those things, these blessings, have changed your life, and how those blessings are influencing my life. How did it impact me and made a difference in my life? Even if you just start with a couple things, oh, that has changed my life, wow. Like you said, dear, thank you for saying that. Those positive things. Count your blessings. There's a song, right?
Count your blessings.
Name them one by one. Count your blessings. See what God has done. Count your blessings. Some of those blessings, and I want you to keep them in your mind. For example, Thank God for my husband and my family. I can't imagine my life without them. Okay, keep that in mind. And then when you come to church and we're singing and we're giving praise to God, that's in the back of your mind. And as you sing, and as you listen to the sermon, you're able to think of those praises, and it will bless you.
Looked like a heart that was on his leg.